So today we have a special treat for you. We actually have Dan Cavalancia is going to speak for you. And those of you who have been coming for a while know that Dan is also our marketing manager. So before he started here, Dan actually went to school for clarinet performance and has his doctorate in clarinet. So when we needed somebody to talk about this, I said, hey, Dan. And this falls under the other duties as assigned. So. A few things. So you, I'm sure, have noticed the balloons and the cupcakes back there. This week is actually our 80th birthday. So on Friday, it is the 80th anniversary of our very first concert. So we're celebrating today. And if you have time at the end and you want to peek into the gallery, if you didn't get a chance to do that at the last concert, we have some historical things hanging up there from the past. On your table is the next postcard. We actually combined, so there's two concerts on the same postcard, so after the first concert, don't throw it away. So we have on March 3rd is the clarinet concerto that you'll be hearing Dan talk about today with our principal clarinetist, Randy. And then at the end of March, we have a cello concerto coming, and I don't remember who. Thank you, Haydn. I knew Julia. It's Julia Bruskin playing the Haydn. There we go. So with that, I'm going to let Dan take over and enjoy.
Michelle's office and said, so for my master's orals, there's a really cool story about the Copland clarinet concerto, and I don't have to talk about it. I have all the info and I can give it to somebody. And she went, nope, you're doing it, and wrote my name down. So here I am. Don't offer yourself up to your boss like that. I learned that quite fast. Thank you all for coming, and this is the only marketing thing I'm going to do, and then I'm refusing to answer any marketing questions for the next hour. Basically, one, I want to thank you all for coming, but two, I want to thank you for coming to a forum like this, where we get to kind of be nerdy musicians for a little while. And from where I sit, both as somebody who's played at an orchestra and sits in the audience and now sits upstairs and does all the administrative work, sometimes I think the orchestra has this air of it's a secret society that you have to know the handshake and the special knock to get in the door to come to a concert. And it's really not that bad. I mean, Gerhardt stands up there and makes a bunch of jokes. It's a good time. Everybody should come. You don't need to wear a tuxedo. But coming to forums like this, we get to tell some of these stories that not everybody knows, and I think they're fascinating to listen to. So as the willing participants of this, go out and share the stories with your friends and maybe tell them that, you know, they don't need the special handshake to get in the door because it doesn't exist. So with that, no more marketing things. So the Copland Clarinet Concerto, amazingly enough, composed by Aaron Copland. He was a composer, American composer of Jewish descent, his 1900 to 1990. Known as, amongst a lot of musicologists, the Dean of American Composition. So a lot of people, whenever you ask for an American composer, he is who immediately comes to mind. He's sort of the poster child for American composition, especially during the 1900s in America. And that was one of the big reasons why he was asked to do the clarinet concerto, was the fact that he was an American composer. For those that don't know, the clarinet being a young orchestral instrument, really coming to being in the orchestra in about 1750, and at that point in time, the most we played are whole notes until Mozart wrote us a concerto. There's not much out there for the clarinet, and it's fun to be a clarinet student walking down practice room hallways because you know what everybody else is playing because you've already played it, because there's like 12 things and that's it. So that's also part of the reason this was commissioned. Now, for a useless bonus point that gets you nothing, does anybody happen to know who did commission this work?
Oh,
Exactly. Benjamin David Goodman, also known as Benny Goodman, or as other people might know, the King of Swing. So what the heck is a swing jazz band player doing commissioning composers like this for clarinet works? So I want to talk a little bit about what got Benny Goodman into this position and why he did this. I'm not really going to talk about his jazz era stuff. Feel free to investigate that. It's a fascinating story. He's definitely one of those poor kids who played or who paid 25 cents a week for clarinet lessons and then eventually became a big band leader and one of the icons of swing jazz and big bands. So from the 30s to the 40s, well, the entirety of the 30s, he's known as a band leader, and he had the Benny Goodman Big Band. When the 40s start, you start to have the decline of swing jazz and the big bands being popular, and all of the various bop versions of jazz are starting to become popular. So Benny Goodman, being a studious man, tried to break into that scene. He wanted to continue on playing jazz for, you know, however many decades. And at the beginning of the 40s, you see him saying things that he likes bebop and hard bop and wants to get into that stuff. And then by the end of the 40s, he's saying it's an awful trend and it doesn't matter what notes you play, it matters who you play them in front of. Which is, I don't know if that's him being angry at the scene or him just not being able to cut it, although I have a hard time believing he couldn't cut it as a musician. So in the late 30s and into the 40s, you see him move away and he starts to get into rediscovering his classical roots and going back and playing classical music again. In 1938, April 25th specifically, he releases his first recording, classical recording, and it's the Mozart Clarinet Quintet. As a clarinet player, you've made it in the classical world when you release a Mozart recording. It's kind of kooky how it's some of the first compositions ever written for the clarinet, but in the clarinet world, they're kind of considered the holy gospels of clarinetdom. I don't know why, that's just the way it is. Some people call them some of the most perfect compositions that even Mozart himself wrote. And so there's the clarinet concerto, the clarinet quintet, and there's a trio, clarinet, viola, and piano. And there's Benny Goodman recordings of the quintet and of the concerto. I'm not sure if there's one of the trio. I couldn't find one anywhere, so I don't think there is. But it's amazing enough to see somebody who is specifically, or at least well known as a jazz musician, come out and say, or come out and produce a very, it's actually a very good recording. He uses vibrato, which is a hot topic, but it's still a very good recording for a jazz musician. In 1946, then, he meets and starts a friendship with Ingolf Dahl, a prominent pianist and music advocate. For those that are fans of Victor Borge, like myself, he was the music director of that as well. How many of you are surprised that I know who Victor Borge is? And they start a friendship for classical chamber music. So when you look, they did all sorts of clarinet and piano sonatas, brought in other musicians, and did loads of chamber works about or regarding with the clarinet and with piano and other various musicians. And Benny Goodman really dives very hard into becoming a classical player again. He even goes so far as to hunt out some of the best orchestral musicians and university professors that are of the time to rework his playing, which, yeah, I'll get to that in a second. And then he also helps out Dahl and premieres his concerto for three, Concerto Autre, in 1948. In 1949, this is out of Benny Goodman's bio, and I kind of wanted to pull out the specific quote. He works with Reginald Kell, who is a British clarinet player that comes over to America, does a lot of soloing and a lot of teaching. But Benny Goodman practically reworks his entire playing. He changes the, what we call the embouchure, how you put the clarinet into your mouth. He changes how he holds the clarinet in his fingering style. This part fascinates me to the point where I guess he shaves off the calluses that are on his fingers. I'd like to think that I've played a lot of clarinet and I never developed any calluses besides what I had on my thumb from the thumb rest. So I don't know if he was just playing ridiculous amounts, or sometimes jazz players do all sorts of things that make us classical players cringe, like how are you making sounds doing that? So he completely reworks his clarinet playing, and there'll be a couple of things that I'm gonna say you should keep this in mind for later in the presentation. This is one of these things that it comes back later, and I think it haunts Benny Goodman a little bit for his procrastination later in the presentation. So because now he has become a serious classical musician again, he's learning what all of us learn as clarinet players. Oh, there's not a lot of classical rep out there. There's not a whole lot that we get to play. And here is a jazz musician with a very prominent name, and he said, all right, well, I'm gonna find a bunch of prominent composers of the day and commission them to write clarinet pieces and make our rep larger. And he does that. So to go down here, the in parentheses is when these works were premiered. And I'll get to the funny stuff down at the bottom with Bernstein and Stravinsky. The Bartok Contrast, which is a piece for clarinet, piano, and viola. The Arnold Clarinet Concerto, the second one. Malcolm Arnold had already written one. Morton Gould's Derivations for Clarinet and Band. The Poulenc Sonata. The Poulenc Sonata is one of my favorites off of this list. High schoolers play this to get into college almost all the time now. It's a very popular piece that has definitely stood the test of time. Obviously, the Copland Clarinet Concerto. I'll get to the funny dates eventually as to why it's 1948 through 1950. And then Leonard Bernstein was actually commissioned by Woody Herman, another big band clarinet player, to do Prelude, Fugue, and Riffs. It was finished in 1949, but Woody Herman's band didn't exist anymore. So who's gonna play it? And it kind of languished in purgatory until 1955, when Benny Goodman got a band together. I imagine it's his old big band, and premiered the work finally. And then Stravinsky also wrote what's known as Ebony Concerto for the clarinet. It's sort of the same thing as Prelude, Fugue, and Riffs. It doesn't use an orchestra per se. It uses a largish big band as the orchestra in the back. Woody Herman in 1945 did premiere it, but then that was kind of the end of it. Nobody cared to play it anymore. And Benny Goodman got together with Stravinsky and they made a recording, which then launched a resurgence of the piece, and it's become another standard. Not many people hear it because it's a weird instrumentation to ask an orchestra to do a big band on stage. But so he commissions all of these works. And as a clarinet player and as somebody who has studied a lot of the clarinet rep, I can honestly say all of these are quite popular. The only one I wasn't really aware of as being Benny Goodman's doing was the Morton Gould Derivations for Clarinet and Band. It's probably got to do a lot with the fact that it's for a band and not an orchestra. There's not a whole lot of soloistic opportunities for people playing with bands nowadays, although college bands are becoming a big thing. All of you should look into college wind ensemble rep if you're looking for new music to listen to. Little side note. So now, actually getting into the Copland Clarinet Concerto. Benny Goodman approaches Aaron Copland because he wants an American clarinet concerto, and he approaches him in 1947. And I put this whole quote up here because there's lots of little gems in it. This is in Benny Goodman's bio, and this is Benny Goodman himself saying this. I made no demands on what Copland should write. He He had completely free rein, except that I should have a 2-year exclusivity on playing the work. I paid $2,000, and that's real money. At the time, there were not too many American composers to pick from. And then the rest of the quote isn't too important. It's kind of funny to read, though, because he talks about the cadenza being a sticking point. And in my opinion, he kind of lies about what he's talking about. But that's just my point of view. And then at the very end, he does mention that they do make 2 recordings together. You'll actually get to hear one today of Benny Goodman soloing on the clarinet and Aaron Copland conducting the orchestra. So the 2 things that, again, I want you guys to focus on and remember is the very first line, I made no demands on what Copland should write. Things you should never ever tell a composer. They have free rein. This comes back to bite them later. The second one is 2-year exclusivity on playing the work. So the goal of this was only Benny Goodman gets to play it, only Benny Goodman gets to record it for the first 2 years once he accepts the work. Don't procrastinate, folks. We'll get to that in a minute. And then the other thing that I thought was interesting is the $2,000, and that's real money. So I threw that into some inflation calculators on the internet and got anywhere between $20,000 and $25,000 for the commission. So yes, indeed, I think that is real money. Aaron Copland accepts the commission. And at this time, he travels down to Rio de Janeiro on a state-sponsored trip, going to spread the word of U.S. music and also going around teaching, playing for a couple of things, and back in the day when they used to try to spread American culture that way. So he goes down there, and he starts writing. The first movement, he composes pretty fast and doesn't have a whole lot of problems with it. I'm going to play a little bit for you here in a minute. It's definitely very reminiscent of all of the Copland stuff you've heard before, kind of Fanfare for the Common Man kind of stuff. It's very open, very large intervals, almost a little mournful. I tend to think, whenever I try and put pictures in my head, I think of going through an old spaghetti western like opening scene where it's the great expanses and the Grand Canyon in the background. And you can come up with whatever story you'd like, but that's mine. Funny thing about this, and this is one of the first hiccups with the concerto, is he wrote the first movement and then he sent it to his friend Kusevitsky, who is conductor of the Boston Symphony, if I remember correctly, at this time. And Kusevitsky said, oh, I really like this. Don't put it in the clarinet concerto. Rewrite it as a strings elegy for me and I'll pay you for it. And Aaron Copland goes, yeah, sure, that sounds like a good idea. And that's the last you hear about it. Now, we know that it didn't actually end up becoming a string elegy, but for a while, there was a lot of uncertainty as to whether or not this first half of the concerto was really going to exist. I do also have up there, it is in sonata form. There is a theme at the beginning and then sort of a development in the middle and theme comes back. This is 1950s, this is Aaron Copland. It doesn't really stay hard and true to the classical forms of Mozart and Beethoven and the like, but for at least the first movement, there's definitely a repetition of the very beginning. So assuming this works, you're going to hear, this is Aaron Copland conducting the Columbia Orchestra with Benny Goodman soloing. And I had to look it up because I wasn't sure. It's the Columbia Symphony. What that basically means is whatever orchestra happened to be in the recording room at Columbia Records at the time, not the country.
Thank you.
it's a lot of whole notes and quarter notes. It's very deceptive when you pick it up as a grad student and go, oh, this is going to be easy. No, it's not. The nice thing about Aaron Copland being alive when he was is that the Library of Congress does have a lot of his writings and sketches. You'll get to see some later, but you also get letters that he's typed and written. This one you can actually read. His handwriting is awful, by the way. So in August of 1948, the clarinet concerto is still dribbling his last little paragraph down here. Is still dribbling, so there's no news on that front. Hope to get there before you leave. There are some other letters out there and concerns of Copland that basically once he gets to getting to the second movement, he kind of stalls. He doesn't have a theme, he doesn't have anything he wants to write, it's just not going well for him. And then eventually, as he's down in Rio de Janeiro, he comes up with a theme based on some Brazilian tunes down there. We'll get to that in a second. The cadenza. So the concerto is a little bit odd in terms of being a true concerto form. You'd have a first movement, a second slow movement, a third movement that's usually a rondo of some sort, if you're talking like Mozart style of composition. There's a first movement, a cadenza. It's a free-form cadenza that sounds a lot like the person's improvising. It's supposed to be Benny Goodman playing jazz. It's all written out, though, and you don't get a lot of room to play around with it. Copland does a very good job of telling you, you're going to play it this way, and that's the way it's going to be. So that seamlessly goes from the themes of the first movement, and it introduces a lot of the themes in the second movement, and then seamlessly goes into the second movement. It's kind of like it's just a 20-minute concerto. There are separate movements, if you will, which are listed in the program if you happen to remember to look in a couple of weeks. But it is all just, there's no breaks at all. So, because I get to do whatever I want, there's no orchestra for the cadenza, so I'm going to talk you through some parts of it, assuming that this works. So there is a chord that's held for a very short amount of time, and then the clarinet starts. Very similar to the beginning of the piece.
Thank you.
There's more later. That ends, and then it ends on a ridiculously high note, and the second movement begins, again, Aaron Copland's own words, an unconscious fusion of elements obviously related to North and South American popular music. For example, a phrase from a currently popular Brazilian tune heard by me in Rio became embedded in the secondary material. What's fun is, I didn't bring up the page, mostly because it's practically unreadable, but there is a page in Copland's manuscripts regarding this piece where he writes pas de deux, which is the type of piece that he was listening to, and you see music written out. And nobody's really sure if that's actually the piece he was using or that's his interpretation of what he then threw into the concerto. It's very, very similar. So it comes back to, I heard this joke years ago and it's still my favorite joke, composition is the act of forgetting where you've heard something. So, this is the same recording. This will be the beginning of the quote-unquote second movement. Again, Benny Goodman with Aaron Copland conducting. So finally, with inspiration, Aaron Copland finishes the second movement. And we don't know 100% for sure when he finished and when he gave it to Benny Goodman. Through context clues, we can kind of... It's probably mid-November, and that'll become a bit of a punchline later. Mid-November of 1948. He finishes and gives it to Benny Goodman. This is a letter dated December 6th, 1948. I'm sure none of you can read that tiny, tiny text. And basically it says, I recently finished the clarinet concerto that I was writing for Benny Goodman. It's in two movements and lasts about 15 minutes. I think you will like it. Which, depending on how fast you play it, yeah, that's about 15 minutes. It's more like 20. So, he sends it to Goodman in 1948, most likely somewhere between October and November. And then Benny Goodman's response, with a little editing, I know we will have a good piece. Oh, but Mr. Copland, I gave you free rein. Remember that? He didn't like everything that Aaron Copland wrote. This letter, the next quote is to Leonard Bernstein from Aaron Copland. The writing was awful, so that's why I typed this one out. Nothing much has been happening. I stayed home a lot and finished my clarinet concerto, Endlich, German for finally. Tried it over for Benny Goodman the other day. He had Dave O, a clarinet professor by the name of David Oppenheim, I'll get to him in a second, around for support. Oh, what an angelicum's that O is, which I think is hilarious. Seems I wrote the last page too high for all normal purposes, so it will have to come down a step. Hilariously enough, he wrote something too hard for Benny Goodman. David Oppenheim, I do want to talk about him for a second. This goes back to Benny Goodman searching out some of the best clarinet players at the time to rework his playing. He is David Oppenheim is historically known as one of the biggest pedagogues of clarinetdom. I should have looked up where he taught, and I did not, which is very bad of me. But he is an excellent clarinet teacher, since long gone, but I have countless etude books and countless solos that all have edited by David Oppenheim. So he was a strong force for turning clarinet playing into what it is today. And it's sort of amazing to believe that, you know, jazz great Benny Goodman sat down with David Oppenheim and said, teach me how to play the clarinet. So the famous joke about, oh, Mr. Mozart, there's just too many notes. Mr. Copland, it's just too darn high. So there's there's one passage in the cadenza, and then pretty much the last page and a half, what's known as the coda in the clarinet concerto, Benny Goodman took a look at it and told Aaron Copland, look, I just can't play it. It's too high. And there's a whole lot of notes. And Aaron Copland looked at him and went, but I listened to a bunch of recordings of you playing. You can play that high. And Benny Goodman went, well, yeah, if I'm making it up as I go along, I'm sure I can. But if you have it written down on the page in front of me and there's an audience, it's just, it's not gonna happen. So, him and Aaron Copland sat down and they reworked that part of the cadenza and reworked the entire last couple of pages. And eventually you'll get to kind of see what they did. But now for, if you remember, Benny Goodman said, I get a 2-year contract, that's all me. Well, they kept editing and he kept procrastinating clear until 1950. He was given the beginning of the 2-year contract in 1948. He performed it finally on November 6th of 1950. He performed it with Fritz Reiner conducting the NBC Symphony Orchestra. This was only a radio recording or a radio performance. There was no live audience. They were in a studio and that's all they did. So there's a lot of debate as to if people want to call that an actual world premiere or not. Did Benny Goodman even premiere his own piece? He premiered it, but did he, you know, give it the world premiere that everybody could hear? So later, November 28th, 1950, Ralph McLean, who at the time was the principal clarinet of the Philadelphia Orchestra, performed it under Eugene Ormandy. That's not Benny Goodman, and that means his 2-year contract must have went up somewhere in there in the middle, in between those two dates. The punchline of all of this is, supposedly Aaron Copland is responsible for scheduling the November 28th concert in order to get Benny Goodman to finally play his own work. The early reception of the piece wasn't the greatest. Composer Vincent Persichetti basically said about it, alternating tunes are employed in an effort to interest the work into a rondo. This is the second movement he's talking about. However, the form goes no further than that of a newsreel misplaced with retakes. It is disheartening. The first movement was an unqualified statement, the cadenza an unmotivated flourish, and the finale a collection of statements. Yeah, it wasn't too nice. The big criticism is basically that, yeah, it's good music, but Copland gets a theme and he plays with it for a few minutes and then he's done with it. And he goes and he gets a new theme and he continues on. Now, there's also still a debate up in the air about his friend Kusevitsky, who he said, yeah, I'll chop off the first half of the concerto and give it to you. Finally, at this point in time, there's a letter written to Kusevitsky that says, I'm not gonna cut it off. The piece is already not so hot as is, according to the critics at least. And I feel like making it half a piece and chopping off the first half of it, it's gonna ruin it even more. And at this point in time, I think there had only been like 3 or 4 performances when he's writing this. So he comes up with a compromise that I have already forgotten the name of, and tells Kusevitsky that he's not going to chop off the first part of the concerto. Now, the one thing I would like to say, Persichetti says, alternating tunes employed in an effort to interest the work into a rondo. A lot of the research that you will see regarding this piece and its form would be to call the second movement a rondo, and in my opinion, it's trying to pigeonhole it into a classical form. So this will be your music theory lesson for the day. Rondo, in sort of the classical form, is the very, very beginnings of what you might think of as verse, chorus, verse, chorus, verse, chorus. You have an A theme, and then once that's done, a B theme comes in, and then it goes back to the A theme, introduces the C theme, and it can go on. I can use all the letters of the alphabet if you want. Usually it stops at about C or D, and then there's a version of the A that is considered the coda. So there are a bunch of people who have tried to shove the Copland Clarinet Concerto into this kind of analysis, the second movement of it. This is the most popular version, where it's alphabet soup, in my opinion. And the coda, the A/B at the end, is basically because he uses the A theme and the B theme and kind of mushes them all together. So looking at that, it's very easy to say why, classically speaking, yeah, it does seem like it's a little disjointed and a little unorganized, but the more and more it got performed and more people listened to it, it started to become accepted. It started to become a love piece, and now it's a standard in the clarinet rep, definitely for advanced players. And of course, I'm sure Randy Klein's gonna do a great job with it. So, as I mentioned earlier, there are manuscripts that are available at the Library of Congress, so you can see a lot of Copland's thinking in the beginning. And what's nice about it is that means you get to see what he wrote before Benny Goodman got a hold of it and changed it. This one you can't see a whole lot, and I'm sure the light in here is not doing me any justice, but there's a whole lot of pages like this where it's just a lot of chicken scratch. But in terms of near the end of the cadenza, which is the first thing that they argued over.
If you can see it, there's notes that go up into the stratosphere over here.
So I plugged them into Sibelius. And the top line up here, where it says original, is what Aaron Copland originally wrote. The revised down here is what is actually in the part. So, and you'll have to forgive me, I screwed up when I was a master's student, and there should be a flat in front of that note, because I know all of you are taking notes on this. So, the one thing is, again, Mr. Copland, that's just way too freaking high. So, I pulled this up. These are written ranges that you give to, you know, early composition students, and if you take orchestration in college, you get to see charts like this for what clarinets can play so that you don't write notes that are impossible for them to play. Believe it or not, it happens even with professional composers. forget about these first two, the basic and the intermediate. The advanced is the one where we want to start. So the advanced range that probably fits at least 97% of all the music
covers. The extended range is what crazy people write. And so to go from there, and it's a challenge to get those top notes out, and I'm sure none of you enjoyed that. Because I don't enjoy playing it.
But you can hear Benny Goodman
playing it. Yes, you can hear Benny Goodman playing it. And he does it better than me, and he also has nice rich vibrato when he's doing it. Yeah. And now you broke my train of thought. No, it's fine. So this note up here, when you do transposition, which if you want to learn about transposition instruments, that's a 3-hour lecture later today. Not really. This note here, it translates to that highest note that I just played. And that's where he wanted it to end. And Benny Goodman went, no, it's not gonna, I'm not gonna be able to do it, you know, as it's written in concert. So he wrote it down like that, and the rest of the cadenza goes on. The second part of it, if you look along here, the top line is the clarinet line. So you can see into here and all through here, there's a lot of notes going on, and it's going at quite a clip. And what's fun about this page, although one, it's impossible to see on my computer, and it's even more impossible to see on the projector screen, is in here and up in here, you can see little tiny smudges. Those are the notes of Benny Goodman circling things and saying, no, don't put that there, put that in the piano, take that, cross those notes out, lower those notes down an octave. And that's basically, he sent that back to Aaron Copland and said, this is my, this is how I would prefer it to go. And my favorite part is the scrawl up at the top. First version, later revised, of Coda of Clarinet Concerto, and the thing in parentheses at the bottom, too difficult for Benny Goodman. Immortalized in the Library of Congress. So this is me plugging it into Sibelius so that you can kind of see the difference. I'm sure some of you are squinting because I have to squint to look at it. But the top line is originally what Aaron Copland wrote. So there's a lot of notes in there. And then when you look at the second line, that's what's actually in the part. And you can see, if you can see my pointer in there,
in here, and in here, they compromised and just wrote less notes. And then for things like in here, where there's just notes missing, they got thrown into the piano part in the orchestra, and in some cases, the strings. And that continues on. And then after that, the cadenza stayed the same until the very end. This is the last page that got edited. So the top line, again, is a ridiculously high note, just a little shorter than what I played, or a little lower than what I played. And that note was supposed to be done over and over and over again. And you have to forgive me.
So for those of you that aren't in the know, this 8 and the dotted line across of it, that means whatever this is, it needs to be an octave higher. So it should be an obscene amount of ledger lines that, yeah, they're hard to read. That should have ended there. This note's supposed to be as written. And again, they compromised, and this revised one is what is actually in the part. I have not confirmed this with Randy Klein, but I assume he's playing what's actually in the part and not the original version. Because, oh dear, I'm gonna
forgive me. All good.
So, and the reason I bring that up is us clarinet players are huge nerds. And there are some of us that are nerds and absolutely crazy. So, there is a gentleman by the name of Charlie Nydick, who his sort of thing that he does in the clarinet world is he finds pieces that were hits back in the day, and by back in the day I mean like the 1800s, that nobody plays anymore, and nobody even has music anymore. Oh, this piece by so-and-so is absolutely fantastic, but nobody has music anymore. He goes out, he does the research, he finds these pieces, gets them republished, and introduces them back into the repertoire. Nydick, N-E-I-D-I-C-H. He is, this is how crazy he is too. He is on the faculty of Juilliard, Manhattan School, Manus, and Queens College, all in New York. I don't know when he sleeps. I don't think he does, actually. I had the unique opportunity to have breakfast with him because he didn't want to go to what he was supposed to go to. So he said, let's have breakfast. Okay, I'm supposed to drive you and you're gonna get me in trouble, but that's fine. So he did a much better job than what I just did and found all of the original notes of Aaron Copland and wrote it all out like that and said, all right, that's the way it was supposed to be. I'm gonna perform it that way. And he has a recording of him performing the quote-unquote original version, 1948. It is incredibly difficult, and I'm going to give you sort of a back-to-back example of what the original version is versus what Charlie Nydick did. There are three recordings out there. There's roughly 20 recordings of the Copland Clarinet Concerto. There's three of people. It's himself, Charlie Nydick. Who's the other guy? Rito Bieri, who is a student of his who teaches in Germany, and a character by the name of Martin Frost, who is a Swedish clarinet player and is known for he likes to combine ideas like playing the clarinet and dancing. There's a great video of him playing on stage with an orchestra roller skating around while playing the clarinet. So he's a hoot. So now, for your listening pleasure, I'm gonna go back and we're gonna play, instead of the bouncing ball sing-along, I'm gonna try and follow along with my mouse for you guys. I'm going to play the Benny Goodman version of the Coda Till the End, and then we're gonna go back and I'm gonna do the Charlie Nydick version, and you can kind of hear what Benny Goodman wrote out. The Charlie Nydick version is amazing to listen to. There's some of it that, in my opinion, it's just a whole bunch of squeakiness, but that's that. So I'm gonna go back there and play around.
So this will be Benny Goodman. Thank you. Charlie Manic version. I know he went around and toured, again, doing things like the Mozart Clarinet Concerto, and he performed this quite a few times in order to get it to become more popular. Anything besides that? Because then he went around and was an advocate for swing music to continue on past the 50s, too. So he was bouncing back and forth between the two. Nothing notable shows up, but he did it. Yeah. He did a lot of radio recording, so I imagine he spent a lot of his time in the studio.
When he commissioned this piece, was he transitioning from classical into jazz then?
Other way around.
Oh.
And that's part of why he probably procrastinated so much, is he's reworking how he's playing. And Benny Goodman is notoriously known for being a taskmaster during his time as a swing band leader. To the point where if you screwed up, there's a story of him actually banishing a guitar player behind the bandstand because he was so mad at him during a concert. So I imagine he was equally as hard as on himself and wanted this to be perfect, and in his opinion, never got it there. Yeah, it's So there's schools of thought on that where normally you curl your bottom lip and then you bite with the top. And a lot of clarinet players will have pads on here like I do, because you can actually, in about 5 years, bite through your mouthpiece and break it. There's a type of embouchure called double lip where then instead of biting with your top teeth, you roll your top lip down too. So you go from playing like hours and hours a day to if then you want to go to double lip, you actually have to retrain yourself how to play, and you start like half an hour a day and then your mouth can't do it anymore. And you kind of, you know, that's probably also part of it, was he spent the better part of a year relearning how to play.
Well, I know a trumpet player that does jazz, and he would study classical, just classical, but I was getting ready with him, and all of a sudden, after playing all those years on band and stuff, I had to play him play on the floor.
Yeah, yeah, it's a different school of playing.
And there are famous people that play, there's a famous theater that was really popular and just wonderful. And then he studies classical music and suddenly can play, so self-conscious.
Yeah.
Tell us, why is Poulenc your favorite?
It's short? No. It has a good combination of, as people will complain, a lot of the clarinet concertos out there, they're about getting on stage and putting your diva hat on and strutting about and showing off, whereas the sonatas are some of that, but also more lyrical. So Poulenc manages that, where the beginning is absolutely crazy, and then it calms down and it turns into a very gorgeous piece. And anything that's French from like the 1920s on gets my vote. Well, thank you. Eat all of our cookies and take all of our coffee.